Hello and welcome. My name is Jennifer Davis and I'm happy to be here today to discuss with you the detection of typical GCMS pesticides in cannabis matrix utilizing APCI-LCMS. Hopefully by the end of this presentation you've learned a little bit about something of the following: what mass spectrometry is, LCMS versus GCMS, the general pesticide analysis in cannabis, different source types that we offer, MRM development, final method parameters used, the sample preparation used, what matrix effects were seen, and then the resulting data that was actually acquired in this application. First, let's start with mass spectrometry in general. Mass spectrometry is an analytical technique that takes a compound of interest and ionizes it. Each ion is then separated based on its mass to charge ratio using some type of mass analyzer and then detected. The final result is a mass spectrum, which plots signal intensity versus the ion's mass to charge ratio. There are a variety of different ion sources or mass analyzers that can be used. Throughout this discussion, we will focus on the use of tandem mass spectrometry. This type of mass spectrometry utilizes a set of quadrupoles for the mass separation. This will be combined with the use of ESI or APCI for the ionization techniques. I will go into further detail in a little bit about what exactly a quadrupole is and how it works, as well as the different ionization techniques we offer. The first example of tandem mass spectrometry I will discuss is liquid chromatography mass spectrometry, or also known as LCMS. This type of analysis uses ultra-high performance liquid chromatography, or UHPLC, for the separation of the analytes prior to their detection. Generally speaking, the combination of LCMS allows for a highly selective and sensitive detection method for analyzing complex samples. LCMS offers the benefit of not needing to achieve baseline resolution for all of the analytes, unlike when you're using just UHPLC. This can help increase sample throughput and shorten the overall runtime needed in a laboratory. A second example of tandem mass spectrometry is gas chromatography mass spectrometry, also known as GCMS. While both GC and LC are an analytical technique used for separation, and both are coupled to a tandem mass spectrometer, they have one major difference. Gas chromatography requires analytes to be separated based on their volatility or boiling point, and uses an inert gas during separation. This requires the analyte of interest to be thermally stable. The downside with this is a huge number of analytes decompose at a high temperature and therefore cannot be analyzed using GCMS. With the increase in medicinal and recreational cannabis legislation throughout the United States, there is an increasing demand for pesticide testing on cannabis products. Pesticides can be insecticides, herbicides, fungicides, basically any product that is used to help protect a crop from harmful organisms and get it all the way to a successful growth and harvest. The problem is, pesticides are believed to cause both short-term and long-term health problems in humans. Because of this, there is an initial regulatory guidelines that are set. Within the cannabis market, this guideline is being set by each state individually. This results in a variation between the number of analytes tested and the required action limits from state to state. For example, California regulates a total of 66 pesticides, and Oregon regulates a total of 59. Due to the volatility of some of these pesticides, laboratories currently require the use of both LCMS and GCMS to analyze the complete list. This study evaluates using APCI-LCMS for the quantitation of compounds frequently analyzed by GCMS. So what is APCI and why can it offer an alternative to GCMS? Normally, when using LCMS, pesticides are analyzed with ESI or electrospray ionization. This is the process of infusing a liquid through a capillary and then applying a high voltage to it as it passes into the mass spec source. This creates charged droplets that are continuously evaporated until the sample ions are released into the gaseous state. Once in this gaseous state, the ions can travel into the inlet of the mass spec and along the ion path for detection. In APCI, or atmospheric pressure chemical ionization, however, the sample is vaporizing using a heater before entering the mass spec source. Because the sample is already in the gaseous state, a corona needle is used to apply an electrical discharge that can then ionize molecules in the gaseous state. This allows us to analyze more volatile compounds while still using LCMS. A third ionization source was tested during this study called dual ionization, or DUIS. This is a compromise between ESI and APCI, utilizing the ESI probe in combination with the corona needle discharge. I am going to quickly demonstrate, when using a Shimatsu LCMS 8060, how to switch from the electrospray ionization source to the atmospheric pressure chemical ionization source, or the APCI source. The total process of switching from one source to another takes less than 30 seconds and can be easily done by any user. In the beginning of this study, the initial evaluation included Q1 and Q3 scans using electrospray ionization, or ESI, dual ionization, or DUIS, and atmospheric pressure chemical ionization, or APCI. Every pesticide currently run by GCMS was tested. Not only were they run using all of these different ionization techniques, they were actually run using hot and cold temperature settings and with and without additives in the mobile phase. All of this initial scan data was then processed to determine the best ionization source and conditions for each pesticide. In this particular example shown, pentachloronitrobenzene, or quintazine, showed the best ionization using APCI. An in-source rearrangement was seen that was temperature dependent. Under colder temperature settings, the precursor could be driven into one particular state, or under hotter temperature settings, two viable precursors were noted. After the initial scans and source testing was completed, any viable precursors were then selected for MSMS scans. This was used to determine their fragmentation patterns. Continuing the example previously used, PCMB under hotter temperature settings had two viable precursors, 264 and 275. Both of these were treated to a number of MSMS scans along a range of collision energies. As you can see in the spectrums displayed above, they gave a similar but slightly different fragmentation pattern depending on the precursor selected. Both precursors had 1 to 5 transitions selected and then was further optimized. The final transitions were tested in both cannabis matrix and as a neat solution. So what exactly is an MRM and why are we using it? An MRM, or multiple reaction monitoring, is a very selective approach for the identification and quantitation of a variety of analytes. This is an example of tandem mass spectrometry that uses 2 quadrupoles for double mass filtration. It offers a great way to get good data with a high degree of specificity and sensitivity. During an MRM, a specific precursor ion of interest is selected and then passed into the collision cellar Q2. The precursor then undergoes fragmentation, and the product ions or fragments are then passed into Q3, where a specific fragment can then be selected for detection. This process of selecting a precursor and then a fragment specific to this precursor is what allows us to have that high level of specificity and sensitivity. After source testing and MRM optimization was completed, the final method parameters were selected to be tested in Cannabis Matrix. The table at the top shows the final MRM transitions used when testing in cannabis extract for all 10 analytes. The interface settings shown are all of the gas or temperature settings used, as well as the LC flow rate and injection volume. The final HPLC gradient had a total runtime of 15 minutes and used a C18 column. The sample preparation used in this study took 1 gram of dried flower and 10 mils of acetonitrile and added them to a clean 50 mil falcon tube. 3 steel balls were then added to aid in the grinding of the sample in combination with vortexing for 5 minutes. Centrifugation was then performed for 5 minutes at 2800 RPM and the supernatant transferred to a vial for injection onto the LCMS. Both a spiked and unspiked sample were treated to this extraction process for the initial method testing. The spike sample included adding 50 microliters of a 40 microgram per mil stock solution of all 10 pesticides. The final on-flower spiked concentration was equivalent to 2,000 nanograms per gram. The sample preparation technique just discussed was done with a dry flower. There are a variety of different matrices in cannabis as well, such as flowers, edibles, concentrates, tinctures, topicals. Because of all these different matrices, as well as the ever-growing introduction of new ones, it's difficult for analytical chemists to account for all the different matrix effects that can occur. Generally speaking, matrix effect is the result of all components other than the target analyte and their effect on the overall ionization. In the case of cannabis matrix, a number of these effects can come from cannabinoids, terpenes, phospholipids, or even the ingredients used in the making of edibles or concentrates, and sometimes even the extract process itself. Basically, when matrix effects occur, it can result in poor data. It can cause inaccurate quantification, false positives or negatives, or an overall reduction in sensitivity. In the examples above, I demonstrate one example of matrix suppression from cannabis flower and two examples of matrix interference. All three of the chromatograms show a neat standard at 6.25 parts per billion. That would be the green trace, and the same transition in a cannabis extract at 6.25 parts per billion, or nanograms per gram on flower concentration, which is shown in the black trace. In the first example, all the way on the left-hand side with chlorodeine, I'm demonstrating matrix suppression. So the green trace and the black trace actually have a concentration difference of 10 times. The neat standard is 10 times lower than that of the cannabis extract, but yet the signal intensity is still very similar, clearly demonstrating that in the cannabis extract itself, there is some form of suppression occurring during the ionization process. The other two examples are of matrix interference. In the case of MGK264, or the middle chromatogram, you can see a decrease in the overall signal to noise. You can also see that there is quite a bit of increase in that baseline itself, making the quantitation a little bit more challenging. In the last example, in the chromatogram all the way to the right, this was done with cyfluthrin, and this was a severe case of matrix interference. The actual surrounding peaks have such a higher signal intensity than that of the analyte peak itself, it was barely detectable. Because this interference was so severe, we actually didn't even end up using this transition for the final analysis. After all of the method development was completed, which included source testing, MRM optimization, the optimization of different source parameters, chromatographic optimization using a variety of different gradients and column types, and then the last step was the cannabis extract process itself. Once this was all completed, the final samples were loaded into an autosampler, and a real-time batch was begun. I have a short clip to demonstrate what the actual real-time analysis looks like inside the Lab Solutions software. After data acquisition, you can open up your data in post-run analysis for a quick check that all analytes have been found and their retention times confirmed before quantitation. Here are some example chromatograms from the final APCI LCMS analysis that was completed. The bottom chromatogram clearly demonstrates that using a Shimatsu LCMS 8060 with the APCI LCMS method, up to 10 analytes were quantitated and accurately identified. The top four chromatograms are just individual chromatograms of four of these analytes that were in the overall method. All four chromatograms clearly demonstrate a nice peak shape and easily detectable at their action limits. Matrix matched calibration curves were prepared using cereal dilution and a spiked flower extract. The calibration ranges from 2000 nanograms per gram to 7.8 nanograms per gram on flower concentration. The final range varied for each individual analyte and whatever their necessary action limit was. All calibration curves were plotted using peak area versus concentration with a 1/C weighting. As you can see, all of the curves demonstrated linearity with an R-square of 0.992 or better. All curves were followed by a QC and a blank to evaluate the overall system performance and to do a carryover assessment. The use of an APCI LCMS method clearly demonstrated that all LOQs were well below the necessary action limits set by both California or Oregon. The LOQs reported for each pesticide had a signal-to-noise ratio greater than 10 and had a percent RSD value less than 20%. and the table displayed, you can clearly see what the set action limits were for both California and Oregon for all 10 of the analytes of interest, and what the actual observed LOQ was seen on the LCMS 8060 using an APCI ionization technique. And with that, I have come to the end of my discussion. Hopefully everyone has learned something new. I'd like to take a quick second to say thank you to Millipore as well as Shimatsu for offering the opportunity for me to discuss this. If you would like any additional information about anything discussed during this presentation, please feel free to go to www.growyourlab.com.